We are here at the Jam Camp, and I have a very, very interesting person here sitting in front of me. Please, could you introduce yourself?
Sure. My name is Luis Suarez. I work for IBM Spain. I'm part of the software group. I'm part of a small group of people called Blue IQ. And our main mission is basically help drive the adoption of social software tools inside of IBM, so that fellow IBMers use these social networking capabilities both internally and externally as business tools.
I appreciate really your speech. It was so nice. It was the title was Living Social, the Connected Enterprise World Without Email. Can you give us, please, a short vision, a short conclusion?
The idea of the presentation was basically to describe a little bit how, you know, we're entering a world where collaboration has got a better place with much better tools, right? And the idea was basically trying to, when I started in February 2008, it was just having an opportunity to break the status quo of how we have done communications and collaboration within the corporate world, where everything seems to be happening through email. If it didn't happen through email, it didn't happen anywhere. So the idea was to show everyone how there is a life after email, there is a life without email, and that in the context of providing an opportunity to collaborate more effectively and to become smarter at what you do, certainly there is a much higher opportunity using social software tools than using email itself. So the way I started was having that opportunity to help everyone understand how if they wanted to collaborate more effectively, they needed to start relying on social tools, right? So what I did, what a better way of showing them than doing it myself. And what I did was I basically told everyone how from that moment onwards, I will be using social software tools versus just email to collaborate and to communicate. And what I have managed to do over the last 3.5 years is to basically move conversations that were happening in my inbox into social spaces. So instead of becoming a conversation of one-to-one, it's become a conversation of one-to-many and many-to-many conversations, right? So the idea was to help improve not just my individual productivity, but also the group productivity of the people that are part of my network, part of my communities, to show them how they could become more effective eventually, by sharing openly, by being more transparent, by leaving behind a tool that perhaps has stranded our capability of collaborating effectively for far too long.
That's interesting. Which tools and networks are you actually using?
Well, I'm using, like I mentioned on the presentation, a couple of months back, I decided to put together this initiative that I call the Big Three. Right. So for all of the different social networking sites out there, whether they're business or they're for fun or whatever else, I decided that I needed to pick three of them and invest in them heavily, as opposed to have multiple presences and spread thinner so that people will have more difficulties in following. So what I did was I settled down on three of them. One of them is Twitter. And the reason why I use Twitter is because it gives me lots of immediacy, mobile capabilities, and signals of what's happening out there, right, with global
it's
events.
It's like a news channel.
It's like a news
and
channel.
And you send things
right.
too.
Right, it's, mm-hmm. it's like a broadcasting channel.
Yes.
Right? So I use Twitter in that fashion. Then I use Google Plus to have conversations. So if there is an interesting topic that I pick up on Twitter that has got lots of signals that interest my network and myself, I bring that into Google Plus and we have a conversation there. That can go for 10, 20, 30, 40 comments of people adding their thoughts and everything else.
How many people are in your circles?
In my circles right now is 1,300, which is triple the amount of people that I follow on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because Google Plus allows me to filter better than what Twitter does. Right? And it doesn't have silly limits with regards to how many calls you can make to the API and all that stuff. It's just basically displaying everything it has.
Do you do more public posts or mass circle posts?
I do public posts, but every so often I do also post onto specific circles that I know will fit in with an audience. But the vast majority are public posts. more than anything else, because it allows me to find them easier afterwards.
And I heard about your Facebook hater.
Yes, I deleted my Facebook account 18 months ago, no, probably 20 months ago. And the reason for that was because everyone was raving about the privacy issues. Everyone is still raving about the privacy issues. But my main issue with Facebook is the fact that, according to the terms of service, they own everything that you post. Your family pictures, your vacation pictures, your links that you share, your conversations with your friends and family and colleagues and whatever else. And I'm not going to allow Facebook to do that.
But what would happen if you do only internal conversations on Facebook, only not public?
But anything that you share on Facebook, the fact is that you cannot take it out. Once it's there, it stays there. No, right? No. And then if you live somewhere else, you cannot take that content with you. Mm-hmm. That's what bugs me. Right? Mm-hmm. Google Plus, for example, I go into the settings, I say, you know, export content, and boom, everything goes, right? Mm-hmm. And I own the content. I have the copyright of the content. In Facebook, I don't. So they could use that information against me, like with marketing, like ads or whatever else, like it has happened in several news items where people, you know, Facebook use pictures of people to entice them to buy products and everything else, right? Mm-hmm. That's the reason that I have with Facebook. As an example, so I don't use Facebook for a particular reason. So I rely on Twitter, I rely on Google Plus, and then the third of the big three is IBM Connections, which is the one that I use for work. I use internally to collaborate with my colleagues, and externally to collaborate with customers and business partners.
My problem, not really a problem, I like to communicate with my clients, but my problem is that they only have email. What do you suggest? What could I do? What could I teach them?
Well, I doubt that in today's age they only use email, right? If you push them a little bit, they will tell you that they're actually using social networking sites themselves, like Facebook. We're talking about 800 million people in there. Right? Twitter is 250 million. Google Plus is 50 million. Right? We're talking about big numbers up here. LinkedIn is 100 million people. Right? So there's a great chance that they have got it there. It's just that they don't want to reveal it because they may be in the experimentation phase themselves. They may be still playing around with it, and they're not sure yet whether they're going to go that road or not. So the best way that you can do with them is you can invite them to have a one afternoon workshop where you guys could explore together how to collaborate more effectively using social tools. So you can put together an agenda of saying, you know, here's what we want to do, here's how we collaborate, here's what we can really do today, how can we improve it with social software. So you basically help them pick up use cases of how they would want to collaborate with you. And each of those use cases will match a particular social tool. And then you can arrange another workshop session, an afternoon or whatever, where you can educate them on just how to use that particular feature, that social software tool, to perform that task. Not the entire rundown of how the whole application works, just basically how you need to do this. And after that, when you actually get that done, they will see that using these social tools is not that difficult. In fact, it's so easy. And they will want to know more. And that's when they will be ready for you to go and say, okay, so now that you guys want to know more, that's when we're going to start using these tools for real in a business environment, right? And then what you do have to do, and this is something that I do myself, still, even 3 years later, is I do a lot of hand-holding, right? So I show people, you know, don't be afraid about these tools. They're there to help us. I'm going to give you some education tips on what you can do to use them effectively and everything else. And I'm always there if they have good questions for support or whatever else. The idea is that if I educate them once and they get it, they usually get it because they're relatively easy, I don't have to educate them again. But they will be using the tools from that moment onwards, which means that all of the time that they usually I will be wasting sending emails is now regained when I don't have to train them anymore and they use the social tools themselves. So it's a bit of doing an investment of time initially where you have to spend time educating them. But after that education is done, you get that return back of saving lots and lots of time of not having to look after an overloaded inbox, of having to actually cleaning up, of archiving, of worrying where the knowledge is, of knowing where to find the experts and everything else because it's out there in the open.
Yeah, nice tips. One last question. It's very nice to talk to you. What about the synchronous and asynchronous communication? What do you think, how many percent is synchronous?
You know, it's interesting that you mentioned that, because to me, that's the future of social networking. And it's funny because all of the social networking tools out there, they only do asynchronous information sharing. Twitter resembles semi-time, real-time kind of thing, but it's not really real-time, right? And all the various other different social networking tools, they only do asynchronous. Right? There's one exception, which I think is the one that is giving them the competitive advantage, which is Google Plus. Google Plus, there are two things happening in Google Plus that are not happening elsewhere. The number one is that it still is a social networking tool, like Facebook is, like Twitter is, like LinkedIn is, but it also adds instant messaging with Google Talk directly from your networks. And it includes as well Hangouts.
Hangouts, yes.
Which is videos.
Yeah.
Which is video conferencing. Yep. And like I mentioned on the chat, when I mentioned on the conversation, on the presentation, just the fact that you can do audio and video allows you to talk faster, to communicate, not having to write. And with the tools that we have today, you can record that video conversation, like for instance you're doing now, and you can actually go ahead and share it in your blog so that people have got the chat transcript, they can see the conversation, they can see the video that you're doing in the Hangout with Google Plus. So you do have a history of what's actually happening at the same time that you're collaborating, both in real time because you're having the video Hangout, or you're doing the instant messaging, and you have the traditional social networking asynchronous model. You basically have to pick up whatever you want to do at any moment in time. But the great thing about it is that it gives you the choice. No other social networking tool gives you the choice of having asynchronous or asynchronous based on the context of what you want to do. And I think that that's where the future of social networking is, because sometimes you would want to connect asynchronously, like share a tweet or share a blog post or whatever else. But sometimes, depending on the needs of the business, you would want to react in real time.
Mm.
And most social networking tools don't have that real time flavor. Google Plus does, and it allows you to have that kind of interaction on top of what you may have been doing over the course of the last few years with other traditional social networking tools.
Luis, so inspiring. I take a lot of things with me.
All right.
I could talk hours with you, but I think you have to get your flight or something like
yeah,
that.
Have to, yeah.
Yes, thank you very, very
My pleasure.
Much. It was a great pleasure for me, and
thank you.
Hope to see you.
I'm sure you will send me back.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much.